Good evening, distinguished guests, our honored speaker, Professor Dan Julia King, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Max Loop, I'm the Vice Chancellor of the University of Surrey. I'm delighted to welcome everyone to University of Surrey's Adams Sweeting Lecture tonight. We're very pleased to be hosting Professor King virtually, although of course we wish this event could be in person. This lecture series is University's flagship public event featuring our eminent speakers at the frontiers of science and technology. In science, we're always pushing the boundaries of knowledge. Never has this been clearer than in the past 12 months. The quest for understanding demands faith, self-belief, and the ability to play the long game. In times of crisis, our efforts also demand flexibility, collaboration, and intense focus. And these endeavors require extraordinary people, and the Adams Sweeting Lectures bring these people to Surrey. So they are named in honor of two Surrey trailblazers of science and technology, both of whom join us this evening. Professor Alf Adams is an eminent British physicist who invented the strand layer quantum laser, quantum well laser, considered to be one of the top 10 greatest UK inventions of all time. And Sir Martin Sweeting is renowned worldwide as a pioneer of modern small satellites, and a concept that has fundamentally changed the economics of the space industry. Tonight, we are privileged to hear another distinguished leader of science and technology, Professor Dan Julia King, on the topic of delivering net zero, the challenges ahead. This is an area of particular strength and interest here at the University of Surrey. In a moment, our MC, Professor Ravi Silva, will formally introduce our honored guest speaker tonight. Professor King advocates a just transition to our net zero target that builds fairness for every citizen in its delivery. And she wrote recently, the UK target of net zero is one we must meet, but our path to meeting it is also important. It must be a path that is fair, engaging with people and the environment. It must offer an optimistic and positive route to delivering this major transition. As we have found with the COVID-19 pandemic, we are learning to live well within our new limits. We can safeguard human health and still find individual and social fulfillment. Living in a way that is light on the planet is a goal we can reach. The past year has shown us how much it is possible and how quickly, when huge investment and government legislation drive public energy and determination. So tonight I salute Professor King's spirit of engagement and responsibility, as well as her many achievements in science, education, and higher education leadership. We value her leadership and inspiration as we strive to change our culture and society to help preserve our planet. So thank you very much. And now please join me in welcoming our gifted MC to the virtual stage, Professor Ravi Silva, who is the director of our Advanced Technology Institute at the University of Surrey. And he's passionate about the contribution solar energy can make to net zero carbon targets. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you very much, Max. Good evening and a very warm welcome to everyone joining us at home for our first ever virtual Adams Sweeting Lecture. I hope you are all safe and well, and that you're looking forward to the next 90 minutes, which is going to be packed full of information on a highly topical subject, relevant all the way across science, technology, and engineering. We will shortly begin our keynote lecture entitled The Path to Net Zero Emissions in the UK. With such current and monumental topic for discussion that has been in the news in the last few weeks, none to say that the government announced its new commitments just today. We've seen Earth summits are going to take place with US and China pledging climate action. So we really are looking forward to the next 90 minutes that will follow with an allotment of questions and answers. So please post any questions in the Ask the Speaker chat box, and we will try to get through as many as possible. Tonight, we are very honored to welcome Professor Dame Julia King, Baroness Brown of Cambridge. Baroness Brown is an engineer. An academic career at Cambridge University led to senior business and engineering roles at Rolls-Royce PLC. Returning to academia as principal of engineering at Imperial College. She then served as vice chancellor of Aston University for a decade from 2006 to 2016. Her current interests include climate change adaptation and mitigation and the low carbon economy. She served as vice chair of the Climate Change Committee from its start in 2008 all the way until 2021. And she continues as chair of the Adaptation Committee of the CCC. She is chair of the Carbon Trust, non-executive director of the Offshore Renewable Energy Catapult, non-executive director of Orsted. She led the King Review for the Treasury on decarbonization of transport in 2008. She was also within the Prime Minister's Low Carbon Business Ambassador for the 10 years. She is passionate about education and engineering. She was a member of the Brown Review on University Funding and Lord Stern's Review on the Research Excellence Framework. She chairs STEM Learning Limited and is the chair of the Strategic Advisory Board of the Henry Royce Institute for Advanced Materials. Baroness Brown is a fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering and a fellow of the Royal Society, and was awarded a DBE for services to higher education and technology. In 2015, she was elevated to a peerage as the Baroness Brown of Cambridge. She sits as a crossbench peer and is a member of the House of Lords Science and Technology Select Committee. It is my enormous pleasure and privilege to introduce Professor Dame Julia King, Baroness Brown of Cambridge, to our virtual stage. Over to you, Julia.
Thank you very much, Ravi. And it's a real pleasure to be here. As you have commented, it's an extraordinarily appropriate time to be giving this lecture, which is great because, of course, it's had to be moved around because of the pandemic. So it's great that it's ended up being spot on in terms of what's in the news at the moment. And with the very positive news yesterday that the government has decided to accept the Committee on Climate Change's recommendation on the level of the sixth carbon budget. So it's a real honour to be invited to give this lecture, and I'm looking forward to your questions. So I'd like to start actually by picking up on something that Max said, which is saying just a bit about why it is that we need to change. Well, the world's top business people think we need to change. This is the World Economic Forum's view of what are the top risks to us globally. And all of those green ones are essentially to do with climate change. So the top people in business think we need to change. The Met Office have some very good data showing us how much hotter it is getting in the world because of human activity. And you can see this is from about 1850 to 2020. And you can see that in the last 5 years, we've had, I think, the five hottest years on record. And if we look further ahead, then we can see that if we go on as we are, we can expect by 2050 to have average warming of somewhere between 3 and 4 degrees. But if we can actually meet the commitments that governments have made at Paris, the 196 governments who signed the Paris Agreement, then we can hope to limit warming to perhaps 1.5, 1.6, 1.7 degrees by the end of the century. So we'd much rather be along that blue path than that red path. I wanted to say to you, why do we need to change? Why is this net zero target so important? And of course, we know and have been hearing a lot about disasters around the world. We've just had the 10 warmest years on record, and indeed the hottest year on record. We've heard about appalling wildfires in the United States and in Canada, and we're beginning to see trends that those wildfires are lasting for longer, are doing more damage. We've seen extraordinary storms, some of the worst ones for the last 20 years, and we're hearing about the impacts of drought, heat waves, and very heavy rainfall on reducing the productivity of really key crops. So we are in danger of a whole range of impacts. So we're in danger of all sorts of impacts, including, of course, hunger, if all of those key crops are not able to be produced in different parts of the world. And we're seeing in the newspaper, this is just an example of headlines from about a year ago, of all of the issues that were around us in terms of impacts of climate change. But it's not just something that happens elsewhere. Although the UK is one of the countries that is fortunately least affected by the changing climate, the impacts are also, not only are we seeing these headlines and things about the impacts on people and the impacts on food, we are also starting to see the financial impact of all of this. And that's really not surprising. So if we look at this chart of the number of natural loss events, the yellow, blue and green parts of the bar, those are all climate related events, losses. And you can see that from the 1980s, the financial losses were about 300 billion. And now we see that they've, in the last 10 years, they've gone up to being over a trillion. And that trend is set to continue. So I just wanted also to add that we don't just have the temperature record. We have a whole range of records from around the world that show us the impacts of climate change. And I've chosen this one because I think it's relevant to the time of year, cherry blossom. But I also think it's an extraordinary historic record which runs from the year 820. In Kyoto, they have been measuring, they have been recording full flowering cherry blossom day every year since 820. And what we see now is that since about 1900, that cherry blossom day has been consistently coming earlier and earlier. So it's now coming some 15 days or so earlier than it was when they first started making those measurements. Now, in a way, it may be a great pleasure that cherry blossom is coming out earlier. But of course, this has implications, for example, for fruit farmers, that if your fruit trees come into blossom before the frosts have finished, as they might do in the UK, you can now very easily lose an entire crop. So that's one of the sorts of implications of climate change that we are indeed already seeing in the UK. So as I say, climate change isn't something that's happening and affecting people overseas. It's also very much affecting us here in the UK. And here is some recent research that shows that down in the southeast, so not very far from where we are, the rate of increase of the hottest daytime temperature is now approaching 1 degree per decade. So between now and 2050, we have 3 decades, we can expect some 3 degrees rise in our hottest summer daytime temperatures. So in Cambridge in 2019, we had 38.7 degrees. By the 2050s in Surrey and in Cambridge, which is where I am, we can expect to be seeing quite frequently, potentially, hottest day temperatures of 40 degrees centigrade. That has implications for our farmers, but it has implications for our homes. These are some flats in London. 2018, if you remember, was a very hot, it was a heat wave summer. The temperature inside these flats got to 47.5 degrees. That makes these flats uninhabitable if they don't have proper shading and proper ventilation. So how we build our homes to make sure that they are sustainable and livable in our future climate is becoming a really important issue. These are the sort of temperatures that can kill elderly people and indeed people who are infirm or even young children. So these are really dangerous indoor temperatures. We're also beginning to notice that water is getting shorter. By the 2050s, around in the southeast, we will be in a water-stressed area, and we will nationally be seeing a shortage, it's predicted, of around 650 million litres of water per day. If we're on a 4 degree temperature path, that red temperature path from that Met Office graph at the beginning, then by the 2080s, the whole of England will be a heavily water-stressed area, and we will be seeing trillions of litres per day shortage across this part of England. So we could be in for some really, really terrible summer droughts. And of course, we've had recently some very bad floods, and we are going to be seeing the flooding situation get worse as we see more winter rainfall as the climate changes. And by even on a 2 degree path, even if we're close to the Paris path, by the 2050s, we could be seeing 2.6 million people living in homes at risk of flooding. But it's not just those sorts of impacts. It's also the impacts of the changing climate, for example, on bringing new pests and diseases. In 2007, there were a few incidences of needle blight in the Forestry Commission estate in Scotland. But only 6 years later, because of the warming climate, the drier summers, the damper winters, it was endemic, pretty much, across the entire Forestry Commission estate, endangering the quality of the wood and the lives of those trees. And in Germany, only a month or two ago, the German agriculture minister has said that their forests are sick. They are seeing severe climate change damage from the increased winter rainfall, the summer drought, the high temperatures, and the pests that can then start to take hold in the trees because of the weakened condition. And they're seeing 80 to 90% of all of their trees are now being affected because of climate change. And they are currently spending 1.5 billion euros clearing and replanting their forests. And they know they will need to spend more in the future. And I think Germany, that's not very far away. You've seen the issues already we have in Scotland. This is the sort of thing that is coming to us. You will not have beech woods with bluebells in the south of England by 2050. Unfortunately, even if we're on that Paris compliant path to hopefully somewhere between no more than 1.5 to 2 degrees, we will still see by the middle of the century some significant changes to the climate, which we need to be prepared for. So we're already about 1.2 degrees above pre-industrial levels of temperature. We can expect another more than a half a degree by 2050. A 2018 summer will be a typical summer by 2050. Our summer rainfall could fall by as much as 24%. Our winter rainfall could be increased, causing flooding by up to 16%. We'll see more periods of short bursts of very heavy rainfall that can cause surface water flooding, and sea level rise could get to about 50 centimetres. That's the change we can't now avoid by the mid-century, even if we're on this net zero path, this Paris compliant path. If we're on that 4-degree path, there's a part of that chart you really don't want to be wishing on your children and your grandchildren in terms of the world they might be living in. And again, let me emphasize, this is not in some island state somewhere. This is in the UK. This is the impact that we will see if globally we can't get ourselves onto this Paris compliant path. So let me, just before we get to talk a bit more about net zero, let me just talk a little bit about history. Because we've known about climate change and we've been able to predict it rather well for an awfully long time. And indeed, the 19th century pretty much had the science of this wrapped up. So we start in 1820 with Fourier, who calculated the temperature of the Earth's surface and needed to include a coefficient for the heat that was trapped or retained by the atmosphere. In 1860, Tyndall discovered that it was just what we now call the greenhouse gases that were absorbing the heat and forming this blanket as part of the planet's atmosphere. Then by the end of the century, Arrhenius was able to calculate the effect of burning coal. Obviously, the Industrial Revolution was well underway, and he was looking at what was the impact of burning all of this coal going to be in terms of this blanket effect on the Earth. And he calculated that a doubling in CO2 would give a 5-degree temperature rise. Well, at that time, the atmospheric CO2 level was 295 parts per million. In April, this month, it's now up to 420 parts per million. It will fall a bit as we move into the summer and the plants grow and absorb CO2, but we're up to an annual average of about 413. And we're seeing 1.2 degrees of temperature rise. So he wasn't very far off. There's no science here to argue about. We've known this since the 19th century. However, some rather better history. This is a very historic document. It's the front page of the world's first legislated climate target, and it's our very own Climate Change Act that was passed here in the UK in 2008. And I hope we will look back on the 5 years from 2015 to the 6 years rather, from 2015 to 2021, and I don't know why I called it 2015 to 2019, from 2015 to 2021, I hope we will be able to look back on these 6 years and say, these were the 6 years that the world really changed. Because in 2015, we had the historic COP meeting in Paris, which led to the Paris Agreement, which came into force in 2016. And that was the agreement, as I've said, between 196 countries to hold the increase in global average temperature to well below 2 degrees and to aim for 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels to dramatically reduce the risks and impacts of climate change. That was followed by the IPCC special report on global warming of 1.5 degrees, which explained why 1.5 was considerably better than 2 degrees in terms of the climate impacts. And it demonstrated the global pathways we would need to be on in order to keep down to that 1.5 degrees. We then have a series of very important issues for us in the UK. The 2019, the Committee on Climate Change produced its net zero report, which said that the UK could achieve net zero by 2050, and that this would cost no more than our 80% reduction target in the original Climate Change Act. So we could get to zero emissions at no more cost than 80% reduction, because so many of the technologies had come down in cost. In particular, things like batteries, solar, and offshore wind had come down dramatically in cost. The government then rapidly amended the Climate Change Act by changing just one figure. The figure, as is highlighted on the slide, the figure 80% was simply amended to 100% reduction. So then last year, the Climate Change Committee published its detailed recommendation on the sixth carbon budget, and indeed the detailed path to getting to net zero. And that's the very first of the UK's carbon budgets, which is aligned with net zero and also with our nationally determined contribution, our commitment to the COP process to reduce our emissions. And in 2021, we hope and expect that this will be the year that Parliament legislates that sixth carbon budget. And indeed, the government announced yesterday that it had accepted the Committee on Climate Change's advice. So we can expect that legislation to come forward very soon. So as I say, it couldn't be a more relevant date for me to be giving you this lecture. And then, of course, later this year, we have the very important COP26 meeting in Glasgow, where we hope that the rest of the world will be signing up to much, much stronger commitments to reduce their emissions. So why has the UK chosen to go for net zero in 2050? Well, the Paris aligned trajectories for better than a 50% chance of staying below 1.5 degrees by the end of the century are those shown by this pink shaded region and the mean being the red line. So this is the way greenhouse gas emissions globally have to come down from today if we're going to stay, if we're going to have a 50% chance of meeting that 1.5 degree target. And you can see that red line actually comes through at 2070. So globally, we have to get to net zero by 2070. But in the UK, we've made a commitment to get there by 2050. And that's because the Paris Agreement talks about countries having the highest possible ambition and being ambitious in the light of their national circumstances. And of course, we are a rich country. So we should meet net zero early because we're capable of doing it. We can be more ambitious. Since 1990, we've shown that we can increase our GDP at the same rate as the rest of the G7 developed countries, and yet we've managed to reduce our emissions much more dramatically than they have, 42% versus 3%. So we've shown that we have the capability and we should be more ambitious. We should also meet net zero earlier from an equity perspective. We're a rich country. We were the cradle of the Industrial Revolution. We have a large historic contribution to CO2 emissions, which are causing the warming that we see today. We also import a lot of things from other countries. So whilst our Paris commitments are on the basis of the CO or the greenhouse gases, the CO2 and the other greenhouse gases that we emit from what we produce in the UK, our carbon footprint should actually take into account our consumption emissions, the emissions associated with the goods we import. And as you can see, our consumption emissions are almost double our territorial emissions and indeed have not been falling at the same sort of fast rate. And finally, we should meet net zero early because we can provide support to the rest of the world in terms of developing technology and taking new technologies down their cost reduction paths. And one of the great examples of that in the UK has been offshore wind, where in a space of 6 years, the cost of offshore wind generation has reduced by a factor of nearly four. So for the initial bids for payments for electricity, the contracts for different auctions for offshore wind back in 2014, the anticipated price was £150 per megawatt hour. The most recent auctions in September 2019, the prices came in at just under £40 a megawatt hour. So a fantastic story of us making this an investable technology. So the cost of investing in it, the cost of money came down, but also driving the technology to larger and larger turbines and more efficient operation, so that we could see this extraordinary cost reduction. So we have a role in helping to bring down the cost of new technologies, and also hopefully in future selling some of those new technologies to the rest of the world as the rest of the world decarbonizes. So now let me get on to what I said the lecture was going to be about, which is the path to net zero. And I think the first thing I think it's always worth remembering is that actually net zero is a significantly tougher challenge than an 80% reduction. And as an engineer, I'm used to saying, well, can't we go with the 80% solution? I think here it really is worth pointing out that the 100% solution and the 80% solution are significantly different. So the black line shows how emissions have been reducing. The red dotted line shows our previous target, which was the 80% reduction. And the green dotted line clearly shows the 100% reduction. And it's very obvious that the green line is quite a lot steeper than the red line. So it's quite a significantly bigger challenge than the original Climate Change Act than we passed in 2008. And here, if you like, is our starting point for getting from today to net zero. And what you can see is that we've done a very good job of decarbonising our power system. There's more to go, but by taking coal off the system in terms of generating electricity, we've produced some very significant reductions in emissions. And now as we go forward with the big increase in generation from renewables and offshore wind, we will be able to get that that power, those electricity emissions down to very close to zero by 2035. So that's a really good news story. And emissions from waste has been a good news story, with things like the landfill tax have brought down emissions from waste very rapidly, although you can see that we need to do some more to continue reducing those emissions. Emissions from industry have been a reasonably good story, although remembering that all of those curves have to come down to zero by 2050, industry emissions need to accelerate a bit. Now, some in the early days, some of that reduction in industry emissions was actually deindustrialization. But in more recent years, that really has been efficiency and energy efficiency improvements in industrial processes. But you can see there are two particularly challenging areas across the middle of the plot, which is the greeny blue line, which is surface transport, which despite the fact that we have the solutions for surface transport, things like electric vehicles, is proving stubbornly high. And the orange line, which is the particularly challenging area of reducing emissions from heat in buildings, particularly in a country where some 86% of our homes are, of course, heated by gas boilers. So we really have got a lot of work to do to get all of those lines coming down at the kind of slope that our electricity sector emissions are coming down on that chart. So getting to 80%, as I've said, was already quite a challenge, but it was going to be done through energy efficiency and electrification, through the phase out of fossil fuels in electricity generation and in vehicles, through starting to develop industrial carbon capture use and storage, a limited amount of bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, and increasing the woodland and the forest area in the UK to absorb emissions as the trees grow. But it left us with 20% of our emissions, the really difficult to decarbonize emissions. Some of the emissions from industry, some of the emissions from heating buildings, heavy transport, really challenging area of aviation, shipping, and some of agriculture. So when we only had to reduce to 80%, we could still have some of those emissions. Now we've got a 100% target, we have to eliminate those emissions. And that's why you've been hearing so much about hydrogen, because hydrogen has a role to play in all of those difficult to abate sectors. So in industry, hydrogen can play a role, for example, in decarbonizing steelmaking, using hydrogen as a reducing agent. It can play a role in heating our buildings, in some of them replacing methane in boilers. It could well play a role in heavy transport with fuel cells. It could play a role in aviation. It may be actually as a fuel in itself, or it may be as one of the starting materials for sustainable synthetic fuels. It will very likely play a large role in shipping in the form of green ammonia. And of course, it will help us in agriculture because we will be able to make green fertilizers as long as we produce that hydrogen from electrolysis or from steam methane reformation with carbon capture and storage. And it will probably play an important role in our electricity system. It may be that we have hydrogen turbines, which give us that peak lopping capacity for when we all put on put the kettle on when we all get home in the evenings, or indeed helping us with storage, because we're going to have a lot of renewable energy on our electricity grid. And so we will need to be able to store that energy when we don't need to use it, and store it also for those times when the wind isn't blowing. So I've been talking a lot about carbon budgets, and I should just make sure that I explain to you what they are. So carbon budgets are like financial budgets. They're how much carbon you can emit, in this case over a 5-year period. And this is the way we set the targets for decarbonising the UK economy. Carbon budgets were introduced in the Climate Change Act. We've so far legislated 5 of them, which take us out to 2032. And the government has just yesterday committed to legislate the 6th one, which will take us out to 2035. And the 6th carbon budget is an important one because it's the first carbon budget that has been set since we made the commitment to reach net zero in 2050. So as you can imagine, it's quite a big jump from the 5th carbon budget to the 6th carbon budget, because we've suddenly got to be on that line of a much steeper slope down to the net zero target. So in order to get to net zero, we have to do 4 types of things. We've got to reduce demand and improve efficiency. So we've got to reduce to some extent, the number of flights we take. We've got to make sure that we improve the efficiency of the insulation of our homes and the efficiency of our heating. We've got to introduce a whole range of low carbon solutions, many of which are to do with electrification. So heat pumps in our homes, electric heat, electric vehicles, but some of them will be associated with hydrogen. So that might be hydrogen boilers. And some of the new technologies will be the carbon capture, so that we may still need to use some fossil fuels, but we need to be capturing the carbon and storing it. The third category is that in order to provide all this electrification, we've got to expand our low carbon electricity system. And in fact, we need to more than double in size our electricity system in the UK by 2050. And then there are still some emissions that we can't reduce, so we need to offset those with negative emissions. And that may be through planting more forests and woodlands and restoring peat, or it may be from direct air capture technologies where we're capturing CO2 from the atmosphere and storing it. And I'm sure it will be a mixture of those by the time we get to 2050. Underlying that are some really very dramatic changes in the fuels that we use. and I think they're interesting to look at. So as I mentioned, our electricity demand more than doubles. So from about 300 terawatt hours per year to around about 720 on our core scenario for the sixth carbon budget work, with quite a chunk of that dark green chunk at the top, being used to produce hydrogen from electrolysis. Our gas consumption dramatically reduces. So our gas comes down from 1,000 terawatt hours per year to something around just over 200. And half of that gas is being used to make hydrogen by reforming methane with carbon capture and storage. And about half of it is probably being used to generate electricity, again, with carbon capture and storage. Our oil demand reduces dramatically, again, from around about 800 terawatt hours down to less than 100. And almost all of that, we think, will probably still be being used in aviation by 2050. And our hydrogen use increases very significantly from almost nothing today to something that's nearly the size in energy terms of our current electricity system, to something approaching 220 terawatt hours per annum, with a very steep increase in growth of this hydrogen economy during the 2030s. So this is the way we're addressing many of those hard to abate emissions that we didn't need to address when we were only heading for an 80% reduction. So our energy system looks very different by 2050. We use about 200 terawatt hours of energy a year in the UK today. The smallest portion of that is electricity at 300 terawatt hours, and the largest chunk of that is oil and gas, the fossil fuels. By 2050, we'll be much more efficient, because electric vehicles are much more efficient than internal combustion engines. Heat pumps are much more efficient than gas boilers. So we will be probably only using in total energy about half what we were using, what we're using today. But the really dominant part of that will be electricity, 700 terawatt hours, and then oil and gas in total, about 300 terawatt hours, almost entirely being used with carbon capture and storage. And that 1,000 terawatt hours includes some 200 terawatt hours of hydrogen being made from the electricity and the gas. But I think it's very interesting to think about what are the implications of this dramatic change in the in what our power and our energy system looks like. But it's not something I'm going to be talking about today, but I leave that one with you. So we come on to the scale of the challenge, and it really is a very significant challenge. This is what we've got to do in the next 30 years. Now, we've done things on this scale, on the scale of any of these things before in a 30-year period. I just think we've probably never done all of these things at once. So we've got to double the size of the electricity system. We've got to probably increase our offshore wind from the 10 gigawatts we have installed today to something like 100. We've got to essentially start a hydrogen industry and grow it to the size of today's electricity industry. We've got to start carbon capture and storage. We've got 29 million existing buildings that'll still be with us in 2050 that need to be moved mostly from gas to low carbon heat. We've got to get to 35 million or so electric vehicles and the charging points they will need to go with them. We've got to increase our forest and woodland cover very significantly and increase the rates at which we're planting trees from some 10,000 hectares per annum to something probably closer to 50,000. That would take woodland and forest cover on the UK, over the UK from 14% to 18%. In order to do that, we have to have significant improvements in the efficiency of our agriculture to make the space for all these new trees. And that will also mean that we need to be thinking about changing our diet. So reducing our beef, lamb and dairy consumption by somewhere between 20% or at an extreme, maybe 50%. that's an enormous amount of change to be delivered over the next 30 years. And it might be more straightforward if we could do all of that with technology. But looking at what we have to do, unfortunately, only about 40% of it can be done simply with technology. So with things like decarbonizing our electricity system, we don't think when we turn the light on and off where those electrons have come from. That can happen without really people needing to engage at all. But some 16% of the change is us changing our behaviors, so deciding to walk or cycle instead of take the car. And 43% of the change needs to come from things where we need to make decisions about the technology on a personal level. So buying that electric car or insulating our homes. We have some 60% of the change that needs to be made involves people and involves people doing different things and making different decisions. So we crucially have to bring the public along with us in this transition. And you might say, well, we've managed that 42% reduction already. But if we look backwards rather than forwards, then of that 42% reduction we've already seen, my quick estimate suggests that about 83% of that has come from technologies, from things that didn't require us to interact with them. So mainly the electricity system. And possibly something about 16 or 17% has had to come from things where we have changed what we've done. So if you compare those two figures, the engagement of people in the next 30 years has got to be enormously stronger than it has been in the past. The good news, however, is that every time we look at this, it gets cheaper. When we back at the time the Climate Change Act was passed, we thought this was going to cost 1 to 2% of GDP. In the this latest analysis the Committee on Climate Change has done for the sixth carbon budget and the path to net zero, we think the cost is probably closer to 0.4 or 0.5% of GDP for the core scenario. And indeed, quite a number of assessments have looked at this and says actually this transition could lead to a growth in GDP of 2% or so. And the reason why it could well lead to a growth in GDP is because at the moment we import enormous volumes of fossil fuels, so money is going out of the country overseas. As we replace those by electricity that we have generated here in the UK, and that's a really positive contribution to the UK and to our GDP. And of course, it's a positive contribution to jobs. And of course, hopefully, many of the new technologies will be a positive contribution to exports as well. So this could be a really positive change for the UK economy. It does, however, require some very significant investments. And the additional investment we estimate builds up by the mid-2020s to about 50 billion per year. Now, let's put that in the context of our infrastructure investment annually in the UK, which is something of the order of 350 to 400 billion. So it's not such a huge additional percentage on top of that. But what this, and of course, most of that isn't going to be government investment. 90% or so of this is going to be private investment. It's, for example, pension funds coming in to invest in the next generation of offshore wind. But what this also shows you is that actually, as we move out to 2040 and 2050, the savings we are making from implementing these new technologies will start to balance out the investment costs. And the really key area where that happens is the area of transport. So there should be plenty of really brilliant business models which should enable us to accelerate the decarbonisation of transport. So I'm just coming to the end. I just want to flag up some of the key things that are going to be happening and we're going to be hearing about. So 2021 is going to be a very busy time for new policies, a very busy time for the government. We've already had, at the back end of last year in November, we had the Prime Minister's 10-point plan, which started with the commitment to 40 gigawatts of offshore wind by 2030, and also the commitment to developing the hydrogen economy. In December, we had the energy white paper. This year, we've got, we hope now very soon, the legislation of the sixth carbon budget. The government will be producing its net zero strategy. The Department for Transport will be publishing its transport decarbonisation plan. Department of Business BEIS will be producing its heat and building strategy. The Treasury will be publishing its net zero review, which will talk about where the costs of the transition will fall. So hopefully that will absolutely have fairness at its core, as Max was talking about. BEIS will also be publishing its hydrogen strategy and its industrial decarbonisation strategy. We'll be hearing about the greening government commitments. So there is an enormous amount that we will, in terms of policy, that we need to be hearing about in the coming year. Not just the policy, not just the intent, but if we're going to be convincing at COP26, we also need to see the action starting to happen to actually move us down this decarbonisation curve. So I want to leave you with just two final thoughts. One of them is, of course, we don't know what the UK will look like in 2050. We can do all sorts of modelling and policy projections, but there will be all sorts of new things that come along. But we mustn't let that stop us from getting going. And I think Greta Thunberg captured that beautifully by saying this needs cathedral thinking. And this is Salisbury Cathedral, a stunning cathedral. As a small child, I was brought up in Salisbury. And of course, the stonemasons who started on Salisbury Cathedral had no idea what the final building was going to look like. It was 100 plus years after they started before it was finished. But it didn't stop them starting, and it didn't stop this from being a brilliant outcome. Now, we've only got 30 years, but some of the research that you're doing today will mean that 2050 does not look like the 2050 in the models of the Committee on Climate Change. It will only be better. So there is real excitement, I think, that, you know, we have time to get new technologies which will make the transition cheaper, it will make the transition better, and it actually will probably have a really positive impact on GDP in the UK. The other thought is that we have to think not only about mitigation, we have also to think about adaptation. Our climate is changing. It will go on changing until we can get to net zero emissions. And in fact, some parts of the climate, like sea level, will go on rising beyond when we get to net zero emissions because of the time lag. So we need to take both mitigation and adaptation into account in our planning. And for me, this picture says it all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Baroness Brown, for that wonderfully enlightening talk and lecture, and really bringing out reasons why engineers need to work with social scientists and all types of disciplines in order to get to net zero. Thank you also for soldiering through the unexpected problems of Teams and Zoom. Sometimes when you tackle the biggest problems in this world, you have to start with the smaller ones. And thank you so much for handling that wonderfully well. So I would like to now open the floor to any questions. And maybe to kick things off, we've got one already lined up. And this allows me to introduce Professor Matt Leach from the Center for Environmental Sustainability, who has a question that he would like to ask. Over to you, Matt.
You identified electrification as a key plank of the net zero transition, and a key part of that is replacement of petrol and diesel cars by electric vehicles. My concern, I guess, is that an important selling feature to the public now for EVs is their low running costs. the Treasury gets something like 4% of their total revenues from fuel taxation and vehicle excise duty. And much of that is currently disappearing as EVs don't attract any such taxation. I believe the government is actively looking at replacing and plugging this gap with extensive road pricing. But I don't think this looming issue has really entered widespread public view. And I guess my concern is that EV uptake, which I think has begun to tick upwards, might begin to stall if people realise that EV taxation is coming along on the horizon. So can widespread road pricing really be brought in quickly enough, given the 2030 EV target and potential popular opposition to this kind of change? Do we need a more open public dialogue around this area, do you think?
I think that's a really interesting area and a really important one for public dialogue. When I was doing the King Review back in 2006-07, we talked about road pricing, and we talked about, you know, the potential benefits, because you would be able to do essentially time, distance, place, you know, congestion, occupancy. You could take all of these factors into account in terms of doing the road pricing. So, you know, when the elderly lady who has to get to a doctor's appointment and there's no public transport service from the village, so she has to drive, but it's not at a peak time, it's during a quiet time on the roads, she could do that for free, whereas the businesswoman who chooses to drive into central London at 8:30 in the morning on her own in a very large car can be charged through the can pay through the nose for it, if you like. You could envisage a system that was I think that could be developed to be fair. But nobody would discuss that in 2006-07 because of the perception of invasion of our privacy and data. But I think since then, we have got so used, in a way, to being tracked by our mobile phones and to the benefits that come from being tracked by our mobile phones, that actually there is now an insurance product that you can buy, which looks at how you drive, where you drive, when you drive, and charges you accordingly. So I think we're much closer to that being a reality. And as you said, I think it's an ideal area for public debate to say what would you feel was fair? What factors should be taken into account in how the road pricing worked? Because I think you could envisage that there might be some quite reasonable solutions to that. So I know that is being discussed, but I'm not quite sure how seriously government is looking at it at the moment. I rather hope they are, because I really do think if we get it right, that could be fair, and that could mean the people least well served by public transport and perhaps the people least able to pay could actually come out doing rather well out of it.
Thank you, Julia. Thank you very much. I'm going to ask a few questions that have popped up in the live feed, and then we'll move to Max, who also has a question. But just to warm you up in terms of not just the weather, you mentioned the fact that there is water stressing at the moment. So one of the questions is, do you envisage water shortages, and how do you think we are going to meet those shortages in the future?
Well, one of the things that as chair of the Adaptation Committee, we spend a lot of time looking at is the modelling of future water supplies for the UK. And I'm particularly interested also in the area of East Anglia, where I am, because, you know, we have the fens, we grow a huge proportion of the UK's salad crops, and yet we're in this water-stressed region. We're also in a region where all of the planning for new homes means that by 2050, 40% of our homes in the region will have been built between today and 2050. So if we take really sensible measures, like making sure that all of our new build is ultra water efficient, if we start to take the 140 litres per person per day water consumption we have on average in the UK, if we start to take that down to something like 90 litres per person of water per person per day, then we actually do have a significantly beneficial effect. And of course, the water companies are also looking at their strategies for reducing leakage, for providing water metering, which we know reduces household consumption, for looking at how do we get industrial use to reduce their consumption, looking at how we get farmers to have on-farm water storage so that when we get that additional rain in the winter, they've got local water storage to give them some additional supplies to use in the summer. So, and also the water companies and Ofwat are looking about at connectivity between adjacent regions so water can be moved from one region of the country to another. And the predictions, when we have the adaptation measures in place, the predictions are that by 2050, if we do the right things, we can avoid a loss of that that problem that we would otherwise have. So that combination of mitigation and adaptation working together will actually deliver a lot of the benefits we need on the waterfront.
Thank you. Another question with regard to Treasury. The question reads, the Green Alliance states that the UK must halve its use of primary resources to achieve a one planet living. How do you think the Treasury could handle this or support that view?
Gosh, that's a very, very difficult question. I mean, I hugely sympathise with it because I do, you know, all of those calculations say we're consuming the world's resources much, much faster than is sustainable. And I think as we, you know, as we look to new technologies, we really have to look to reuse and recycling and all of the circular economy principles. And I think it, one of the things that I do see that's encouraging, nothing to do with the Treasury, but it is these trends for all sorts of, particularly amongst the younger generation, for all sorts of new apps for selling your clothes when you've got fed up with them, exchanging furniture so I think we are beginning to see more of a circular economy culture, a culture. You know, the number of cars per head in London is dropping really quite fast, and there's lots more interest in car clubs and car sharing, and I think those trends need to be encouraged. And so if the Treasury can find ways to encourage those sorts of behaviours, then I think that would be really helpful.
Thank you very much. Maybe I can now introduce Dr. Andrew Jackson, who's also from the Centre for Environmental Studies. And again, the university is very well known for the life cycle analysis and all of that activity that was introduced. So Andrew has a question too, and over to you, Andrew.
So to meet the 1.5 degree or 2 degree centigrade target, the world has to coordinate on net zero and achieve most of it early. Long-term commitments have improved the prospects of us meeting these targets, but not enough. What coordination can the UK arrange as part of COP to encourage the transition?
Well, I think we are seeing some encouraging announcements, and clearly the announcement that China was targeting net zero by 2060 is very encouraging. The United States coming back into the Paris Agreement is, of course, hugely important. And we're starting to see announcements from even from Australia about developments of hydrogen and carbon capture and storage. So I think that the work the UK has been doing with some of these countries, and I know it's been working with Australia, I think is starting to be beneficial. Clearly, there are still some very major emitters like India that need to be brought into the fold. But I think, you know, I think one of the best things we can do is set an example and show that we are setting ourselves really tough targets and we mean to achieve them. So actually demonstrating delivery, not just announcements, will be hugely important between now and November. But I think also making sure I think it's really disappointing that we've had the cuts to the overseas aid budgets. And I think a real focus, I would like to see that restored, and a real focus on helping the helping less well-off countries, both to move to low-carbon technologies, but also, as we do with a lot of the aid budget, also to help them with adaptation planning and making the changes they need to make them more resilient to the changing climate is hugely important. But I do think we should be doing more to support technology transfer, and of course also to educate people from less well-off countries, less developed countries. And that's been a really heartbreaking consequence of the cuts to the overseas aid budget have been, you know, the cuts to projects with, you know, funded by the Royal Society and the research councils and things, where we were indeed, you know, universities were able to collaborate and to help educate the next generations of researchers and decision makers in those countries to get the transformation going in their countries effectively. So I think that's very disappointing, and I hope we see that change.
Okay, thank you, Julia. That's very kind of you. Could I now switch to two questions on the government, because you brought up the fact that there are government policies that are coming through, and up to seven major policy documents coming out. And there are two questions here. The first one is verbatim is, if the government keeps missing their own targets, is there any point in pushing targets, or should we spend our time holding them to existing ones?
Well, given that we have passed net zero into law, we just meeting existing targets isn't going to get us there. So I think we need to, that the government needs to demonstrate between now and November, if we're really going to have the influence we need at the COP, that it intends to meet the new targets. And we need to see some action. And, you know, we haven't got off to a great start with the withdrawal of the Green Homes Grant, with the messing around over a Cumbrian coal mine, with the I think there are something like six airports planning expansion at the moment. And I think we need to see government working much more effectively right across government. And we need to see that every government department is impacted by this. This isn't just something they do in Bays. This affects every decision, every spending decision, every piece of new policy, pretty much in every government department. And we need to start seeing them doing those climate change assessments on all of their new announcements and funding.
Absolutely. And this leads on to the next question. With Alok Sharma taking on the presidency associated with COP26, do you feel there could be better diversity at the highest level in terms of COP26 aspirations and delivery?
Gosh, I'm not quite sure I understand the question, but I'm all in favour of diversity of all kinds. So gender diversity and ethnic diversity, but also diversity of thought. And you know, I hope, and diversity of experience. And so, you know, I think the COP is a brilliant opportunity for Western countries like ours to listen to some of the countries, and indeed some of our Commonwealth partners, who are already seeing some very severe impacts of climate change, and who are developing ways of improving their resilience, which I think we can learn from in the UK.
Thank you for that answer. I wasn't sure also as to what it was leading to, and whether it was the five themes or whether it was something else that was being looked at. We've got Max, who's been waiting patiently to ask a question from you. So Max, over to you to ask your question.
Thank you, Ravi. Julia, that's a fantastic talk, and I really enjoyed lots of insights, and I learned so much. Not least in hydrogen, that is my own research passion. I did a lot of work on green hydrogen production from solar energy, as well as hydrogen storage. So can I ask you a quick question about the energy mix? And the hydrogen, as you presented by mid-century, only makes up about 20% of the energy mix. So do you see there's a nuclear that's going to produce green hydrogen much more efficiently than electrolysis? Do you envisage that we'll use hydrogen as a clean energy carrier a lot more than the 200? That's basically a technical question, but I like your quote about the cathedral thinking, because 30 years time frame is enough to produce, you know, the technologies, the next generation of green technologies are going to produce hydrogen or even beyond hydrogen, you know, who knows? So because by the trend of solar PV and all this, you know, the price is coming down, technology become more and more mature. Next 10 to 20 years, there will be a lot of new technology emerging. So I'd like to hear a bit of thought from you on that.
Yes, and I would say in the Climate Change Committee, we're always quite conservative about what we assume will happen. So we essentially, most of our modelling out to 2050 is based on technologies that are already with us and mature, like offshore wind, or technologies that we have already seen demonstrated. So things like direct air capture, we're quite cautious about that. Although we believe it's, you know, we believe it can happen, we've seen it demonstrated, we're quite cautious about that in terms of its cost. So we don't stick our neck out. So everything new that can come along typically reduces the cost of the transition, can accelerate it. Everything that is better than that will reduce the cost and potentially enable us to do things more quickly. And I think you make a good point about hydrogen. If we can produce electricity more cheaply, if we can produce the clean hydrogen more cheaply, then it potentially can play a significantly larger role. So again, any technology developments that help that could mean we have quite a lot more hydrogen. Some of the really exciting research looking at ways of storing hydrogen, some of the beautiful work that's been done on creating nanostructured particles which absorb the hydrogen so that you have something, you know, almost simulating solid hydrogen, and you could then pour these particles into a fuel tank or something, warm them up to 120 centigrade, the hydrogen's released, can be used as a fuel. You know, if we can really make developments like that work, you could revolutionize part of the hydrogen system by making hydrogen storage much cheaper and much safer. And that would enable hydrogen use much more widely. So yes, you know, there's enormous room for technology developments. I hope we're going to see some of these sorts of exciting developments actually come to maturity. And also we must remember the world doesn't stop at 2050. We haven't solved the problem by 2050. We have to keep going. So even if things take a little longer, there's still plenty of space for them to make a difference.
Thank you very much, Julia.
Thank you very much, Julia. Let me ask the final question from you in terms of getting to net zero. You very clearly highlighted the fact that people and society need to change, and there's 60% of change, behavioral change, societal change that is needed. What key message could you give our audience as to what you would like them to do with Earth Day and Earth Week happening this week, and all of the different government reviews, etc.? What can people do to help reach this goal?
I would like to say I would like them all to sign up as STEM ambassadors and get out into schools and make sure that all of our all of the next generation are desperately wants to be scientists and engineers, and that they all understand the climate change challenges that we have to solve, so that they're ready to change their own behaviours, but they're also ready to invent whatever it is, the new hydrogen the new hydrogen storage technology, the new ultra-efficient solar cell technology, whatever it is, the new things that are going to help us make this transition effectively.
Thank you so much, Dame Julia King. You've been an inspiration to all of us, and unfortunately, it has come to the end of the event now. The University of Surrey would like to thank you, Baroness Brown, for such an insightful lecture this evening. We'd also like to thank Max Lua, President and Vice Chancellor, as well as Professor Alf Adams and Professor Martin Sweeting. Furthermore, anyone who has attended the evening and who has contributed to the question and answer sessions, we apologize if we haven't been able to answer all your questions. We very much look forward to seeing you in person for the next Adams Sweeting lecture in the future. Please check back on the website for any future updates. Thank you all for your participation.